In Frederick's time, however, most of the inhabitants of Potsdam were soldiers. Almost all the buildings in Potsdam had some sort of military connection or purpose.
Today, it's a bank, but in Frederick's day, that was the guardhouse. And this Baroque beauty was the military orphanage. Back there is where the garrison church used to stand, and this is all that's left of the riding school.
Even in this seemingly ordinary residential street, the houses were built with an extra top floor for use by lodging soldiers. The army ceased to be merely an instrument of dynastic power. It became an integral part of Prussian society, with Junker landlords as the officers and peasants as the men.
It was once famously observed, the Prussian monarchy is not a country which has an army, it's an army which has a country. Here, society and the military became inextricably intertwined. If you were a landowner, you were expected to serve as an officer. Ordinary men took the place of mercenaries in the ranks. Prussia was the army, and the army was Prussia.
A focus on drill and professionalism was paramount in Prussia's military success. The discipline and speed with which the Prussian infantry could redeploy in the midst of battle was legendary.
This lovely contemporary map allows you to follow the course of the Battle of Leuthen, fought in December 1757, when the very existence of Prussia was threatened by a formidable coalition of France, Russia, and Austria.
Not for the first time, and not for the last, the West was at war with itself. But it was precisely this kind of conflict that spurred innovation. In this 1930s reconstruction, you can see how the Prussian infantry surprised the long Austrian line on its southern flank.
As the Austrians were rolled back, they tried desperately to regroup, but they were hit first by the Prussian cavalry and then by Frederick's lethally accurate artillery. It was a devastating lesson in the science of war. Artillery was as crucial as mobility and discipline to Prussia's rise. We're fighting against more than men, Frederick argued. The wars we're waging from now on will be a question of artillery duels. At Leuthen, the Prussians had 63 field guns and 8 howitzers. They had 10 so-called Brummer, growlers, known as such because of the rumbling noise they made when fired. Weapons like these exemplified the application of scientific knowledge in the realm of military power.
Mobile, accurate artillery was the key to a Western military predominance that lasted for more than 200 years.
The application of science to artillery perfectly illustrates the process of cumulative advance that was happening in Europe as rival states competed with one another and learnt from one another.
The scientific revolution was a field day for creative nerds. In the 1740s, a self-taught mathematician called Benjamin Robbins applied Newtonian mechanics to the problem of artillery, using differential equations to provide the first true description of the impact of air resistance on high-speed projectiles. By measuring the influence of wind and air, Robbins was able to achieve an epoch-making improvement in the accuracy of field guns. It didn't take Frederick the Great long to commission a German translation of Robbins's New Principles of Gunnery. The translator, Leonard Euler, couldn't resist improving on the work by adding a comprehensive appendix of tables determining the velocity, range, maximum altitude, and flight time for a projectile fired at a given muzzle velocity and elevation angle. The killer app of science had given the West a truly lethal weapon, accurate artillery.
But But this ballistics revolution was something from which the Ottomans were largely excluded. Only slowly, in the course of the 18th century, did it dawn on the Ottomans that they had to get up to speed with the Western revolutions in science and in government. And one obvious way to do that was to start publishing and reading books, instead of relying on the traditional scribblings of the calligraphers.
Among the first Ottoman printers was Ibrahim Mutafarika, an Ottoman official and polymath born in Transylvania.
In 1731, Mutafarika presented to Sultan Mahmud I this book, His Rational Basis for the Politics of Nations. And in it, he asked the question that's haunted Muslims ever since. Why is it, he asked, that the Christian nations, which used to be so weak compared with the Muslim nations, now dominate so many lands and even inflict defeats on the once victorious Ottoman armies? Well, Mutafarika's answer to the question ranges pretty widely. It covers, for example, the Dutch and English parliamentary systems, the Christian conquest of the New World and the Far East. And he also makes the point that whereas the Ottomans ruled on the basis of Sharia law, religious law, in Europe, he says, the laws are invented by reason. The message is really clear. The Ottoman Empire has to get the scientific revolution and the Enlightenment if it's to remain credible as a great power.
Books alone wouldn't suffice. Military reform meant importing Western expertise. A French officer of Hungarian origin, François de Tott, was brought in to oversee the construction of new defences around the capital.
Boating his way along the Bosphorus, de Tott noticed that many of the fortifications were quite wrongly located. Any enemy ship would have been completely out of range. The Ottomans might as well have been firing blanks.
In his memoirs, de Tott was scathing about the Ottomans, calling their castles more like the ruins of a siege than preparations for a defence. Determined to modernise the Sultan's antiquated armed forces, de Tott started a course in mathematical science for the navy. He built a new foundry for the manufacture of howitzers and encouraged the creation of mobile artillery units.
Even the Ottoman army had to march to a brand new beat. Just imagine arriving here in Istanbul in the mid-19th century. You'd probably have expected to be greeted by those terrifying drums that put the fear of Allah and Muhammad in the defenders of Vienna back in 1683. But instead, the sound that would have greeted your ears would have been composed by Giuseppe Donizetti, who'd been imported from Italy to compose a special Italian-style and rather operatic national anthem for the Ottoman Empire.
The most enduring symbol of the era of reform was built by Sultan Abdul Mesid I. A fluent French speaker, Abdul Mesid was determined to emulate Western civilization in every respect. So he moved from the cushioned comforts of the Topkapi Palace, the ancestral home of the sultans, to a new custom-built westernized seat of government, the Dolma Bahachi Palace. Built between 1843 and 1856, the Dolma Bahachi Palace has no fewer than 285 rooms, 44 halls, and one spectacular crystal staircase. 14 tons of gold leaf were used to gild the palace ceilings, from which hung a grand total of 36 chandeliers. The grandest room is this, the Muayyedi Lounge. It has the largest one-piece carpet in the world, and a chandelier that weighs over 4.